Data Skeptic is the official podcast of dataskeptic.com, bringing you stories, interviews, and mini episodes on topics in data science, machine learning, statistics, and artificial intelligence.
Tim Henderson holds a BS in computer science and a PhD in electrical engineering and computer science from Case Western Reserve University. He currently works as a software engineer at Google. Tim's research areas are in data mining, software engineering, and program analysis. When he's away from the computer, he likes to run, hike, camp, read, and occasionally paint. Tim, welcome to Data Skeptic.
Thank you, Kyle. I'm glad to be here.
Yeah, I'm really glad you had a chance to take some time out of your day and chat with me about this very interesting topic. I was doing some searching around just to refresh myself a little bit for recording this podcast on the relationship between complexity theory and cryptography, and I came across an excellent summary on your blog. Before we get into that, tell me a little bit about your blog.
My blog is I basically do two things there. I write longer form articles on things that are interesting to me. So right now I've been writing things about lexical analysis or how you break up pieces of text into their sort of categories from a syntax perspective for programming languages, things like that. And then my academic research I put on there as well.
Very cool. And give out the URL so people can check it out.
Yeah, it's Hackthology, which is like anthology, but with a hack in front of it. So HackThology.com.
Excellent. Well, I'll have it in the show notes as well. So jumping into our topic then, maybe we should start with a brief overview of like the purpose of cryptography. Why should we want to encode messages?
Encryption has become, in our sort of modern society, what undergirds how we do everything from have this conversation we're having right now to using cell phones to making online purchases. If you don't have a way to authenticate person you're communicating with, especially in an automated fashion, we can't do things like send credit card information over the internet, and we would not be able to have something like Amazon.
Very primitive codes, you know, things we learned as children were like simple skip things. You know, you take every letter and you move it up two letters, Z becomes B, and so on and so forth. And these are pretty easy to reverse engineer, so we don't think of these as good codes. With that in mind, I guess, what makes a encryption scheme an attractive one?
Encryption scheme that you're sort of mentioning is sometimes called the Caesar cipher. It's supposedly used by Julius Caesar to communicate with his generals so that the couriers couldn't see what they were talking about. These are sort of called classical cryptography schemes. And there's sort of a definition, a mathematical definition of what makes them secure. And it basically says that you gain no information about the message by looking at just its encoded form, which is sometimes called the ciphertext. And this is like a really attractive definition, and a lot of people really like it. The problem with it is you need a way under this sort of classical cryptographic framework to make sure that both you, the person who's sending the message, and the receiver, you know, your company, maybe if you're a spy, the CIA or whoever, has a way to decrypt what you're sending. And these things that you're using to decrypt are called the key. And with this sort of classical cryptographic framework, the key is basically the same size as the message, which means that you need a really secure way to sort of move around large amounts of key material, which are basically lists of random numbers, and distribute them to, say, if you're an intelligence agency, your agents in the field. This is really difficult in sort of the modern context, where every time you go to a web page, you need to connect to it. What was developed starting in the sort of the 70s was a new way to do cryptography, where we sort of got rid of the old definition of what it meant to be secure and replaced it with a new definition that really talked about being no way to extract any information, make it so that it was infeasible or very difficult or would take your adversary a really long time. And with the new systems, which are called public key cryptography systems, we're able to come up with ways to solve this problem of providing the key to encipher the message that people are sending without having to exchange large amounts of information in some sort of secure way beforehand.
Makes sense. Yeah. So very few people, I think, have to worry too much about security beyond setting some passwords or maybe one time setting up an SSH key. We just want all of our encryption to be in place. We don't want to have agreements with all these people. Is that kind of why we don't use the you know, secret pad you were describing?
Yeah, that's basically it. I mean, imagine that you are visiting a website you've never been before and you would like to purchase something from that website. For instance, I just went and made a purchase for Christmas for my son from a website I hadn't been before. Now, I wouldn't have trusted that I could do that without this ability to sort of establish a relationship or a secure way to communicate with that website using a trusted third party, which is how it works on the internet today. There's these third parties that are able to sort of help us set up that connection and be sure that I'm actually talking to the company that I think I'm talking to. Otherwise, that company would have to like send me like, I don't know, a USB key in the mail. It has their like thing to set up and I plug it in my computer and it does something. It makes everything seamless from the endpoint of a computer user.
So those messages that you're then sending back and forth between yourself and the e-commerce site, they're traveling along the internet. And although they're encrypted, I guess someone who's a snooper in the middle somewhere maybe has, you know, access to part of the internet that does a lot of routing. They could certainly be looking at the messages you're sending. And if they want to decrypt them, earlier you'd said, well, it would take your adversary a long time to do it. Why do we think it would take them such a long time?
The attacker is sitting somewhere in between you who is sending your messages and the person who's receiving the messages, or reverse if you're the person who's receiving the messages. In the internet context, you could think of this as somebody who is controlling the Wi-Fi access point you're using, say in a coffee shop, or is just able to listen to your traffic of your cell phone. Cell phones are just radio, so anybody with a radio can tune in and listen to cell phone conversations. Luckily, they are enciphered. Getting back to your question, how confident should we be in this enciphering? It kind of comes down to the mathematical problems that are used to do this public key cryptographic operation. These problems have a certain form, which is called a sort of a one-way function. It has this property that it's easy to compute the function. So if the function is f of x and it creates a new number y, it's easy to go f of x of y, but it's hard to do the inverse operation, take y and find x. This is the asymmetry which allows us to do the cryptographic operation. And so we have different proofs about how difficult it is to do the inversion operation relative to the original function computation.
Can you describe a little bit about how encryption works from a complexity theory standpoint? What is the actual algorithm one would have to go to reverse the one-way function?
A lot of the problems that we currently use in modern cryptography are what are called number theoretic problems. That means that they come from the line of math concerned with things like prime numbers. It is difficult to do certain operations in number theory other than trying all possibilities. So to give you an example, one of the problems is called the discrete log problem. It's a very important problem for establishing connections between your computer and a server. In the discrete log problem, what you do is you have a problem where one side, the easy side, takes a number as the base, we can call it A or whatever, and it raises it to some power, which we call X. It takes the output Y, and it makes sure that it is inside of what is called a prime group. And the way it does that is it repeatedly divides the number by the prime until the result is less than the prime. So it sort of does long division. So if the number is, you know, 50,000 and the prime is 5, it will divide 50,000 by 5 and take the remainder, which would be 10,000. And then it would divide 10,000 by 5 and take the remainder and do it again and again until the result is 5 or less. This final number is the result of doing all these operations. And you cannot figure out what X could have been, the power that you raised your original number to, without going through and trying every X until you find one that gives you the result that you're looking for. And so the larger your prime group is, the harder that problem is to solve.
So you've described a couple of nice properties of the discrete log problem. It's very difficult. You almost have to use brute force to figure out what X value was used. So if an attacker can't have any hints or whatever to figure that out, they're going to have a very hard time decrypting any message you send, as long as you use a big enough key. So that sounds a little bit like these NP-complete problems we've talked about on the show recently. If you factored two prime numbers and you gave them to me, and I could easily verify that they were factors of some large number, but finding them is, of course, the challenge. And you said, hey, we might have to try every X. Does that mean that problems like discrete log problem are NP-complete problems?
No, not necessarily. So the discrete log problem itself is not NP-complete. It is an NP, which means that it has an easily verifiable solution, which is that if you have an X and you have the number that X was raising to the power and you have the final result, you can easily check that result is the correct one. But it is not NP-complete, which is to say that it is as hard as every type of problem that has an easily verifiable solution. It does not necessarily take exponential time to solve. It takes what is called sub-exponential time. Like many problems actually in NP and NP-complete problems, there are certain versions of the problem or certain what are called instances that are really easy to solve and can be solved in polynomial time. When you're designing a practical cryptographic system, you have to be aware of all of these nuances and make sure that you pick your variant or your instance really carefully to avoid picking something that's going to be very easy for an attacker to solve.
What's an example of something that could be easy for an attacker to solve?
This kind of gets into some technical details. So if your prime is P, P minus 1 is not going to be prime, and it's going to be factorable. And if all of the factors are small primes, then the problem can be solved in polynomial time. It gets into these technical points from number theory and facts about number theory and the algorithms that are used to speed up the computation of the discrete log problem when you're solving it.
It's interesting, you know, people always seem to have an understanding that factoring has something to do with encryption because factoring is hard. But as you point out, actually, factoring is often easy. I can factor an even number very quickly, and that's half the numbers. So there's a lot of nuances that go into, I guess, designing a cryptographic system. Have you seen new developments, or what do we generally use on the internet and whatnot in terms of the cryptographic algorithms that are implemented in systems?
So the new developments, I'm not super familiar with their mathematical underpinnings, but the big development that we use is elliptic curve cryptography, which actually also makes use of the discrete log problem. It just makes use of it in a sort of a different setting, in the setting of elliptic curves, where you construct sort of a mathematical universe that looks similar to numbers divided by in a prime field. So instead you have the elliptic curves as sort of your field. And I'm not very familiar, so I don't want to talk too much about that. But that is sort of the direction where things are sort of moving to try and get out of just using number theoretic problems in practical senses. But there are also a lot of interest in finding entirely new problems that have nothing to do with number theory and nothing necessarily to do with sort of classic math problems like polynomial curves and things, and look at more problems that we already know to be very difficult to solve. And so this is where NP completeness comes in. And people are interested in finding an NP complete problem that we can use to do cryptography on. There are other areas that people are also exploring, like things with names like lattice cryptography. But the article I wrote was more interested in the ones that are founded on complexity theory.
It seems intuitive that, at least to me, that cryptography should have to be married to complexity theory, because that very fundamental point that we want it to be hard for our adversary to break our code, or maybe, you know, epsilon close to impossible if it can be, that is, by its very definition, a complexity problem. Would you agree with that point of view?
Yeah, I think so. And sort of the people who are looking into this problem and have been for a long time, really since public key cryptography and the NP completeness problem came about, you know, they're interested in applying these problems to cryptography so that we have a sort of a base for our cryptography, which we can really believe in. Because although it's not known whether or not P does not equal NP, it's almost certain that that is the case. You'll be hard pressed to find a professional computer scientist or mathematician who who doesn't really believe that, even if we can't prove it. Whereas with the number theoretic problems, there are certain advances that seem to be being made on them. If we had a crypto system that was based on, say, the traveling salesman problem, we could know that traveling salesman problem is really hard and we're not going to make any sort of real progress on it. But we get into sort of this other problem at this point, which we haven't really discussed, which is with the discrete log problem, these other number theoretic problems, it's sort of relatively easy to pick a particular instance, which means picking a prime of a certain size. With the NP complete problems, picking an instance becomes the real challenge to making the cryptographic systems work. I mentioned that there are certain primes that are not suitable for the discrete log problem because of various facts. You know, we know a lot about these things, and there's an algorithm for choosing appropriate primes. And it's important to choose a random prime. If somebody can guess how you chose the prime, then the cryptographic system is broken. And in fact, this has happened in the real world a number of times and has, like, caused huge problems. I believe it's actually, there's an ongoing crisis with Finland's e-identity cards. I forget what they're called. The smart card was choosing primes in a predictable way. So it's really important to choose something random, but it's also important to choose something difficult to solve. With NP-complete problems, that turns out to be a lot harder than it sounds. We're not exactly sure what makes a particular instance of a problem. So, like, the traveling salesman problem is, like, sort of a class of problems for how a traveling salesman would visit different cities to sell his product. An instance of that is, like, a number of cities and their connections and distances between them. So it'd be like Cleveland, Chicago, LA, Austin, New York. That's an instance of the problem, and then you can pick an optimal route. Figuring out how to choose these instances so they're actually very difficult to solve rather than very easy to solve, which is often the case, is the challenging bit.
So I've been trying to stress as we do some of these topics on complexity theory that there are a lot of really interesting open questions. You've already mentioned the P versus NP problem that we had a whole show on a couple weeks ago. It, you know, if your life depends on it, definitely vote P not equal to NP. That seems like the right answer, but we just don't know. Similarly, we think factoring is very hard. We don't have a proof of that. Could it be that some spy agency has cracked these problems and that to them encryption is broken? Do you worry that there could be some secret thing going on like that?
I do worry about it, especially for the factoring problem or and related problems with the prime numbers. For instance, since everybody's using this problem, what if you just had been computing larger and larger prime numbers and keeping them secret since, you know, the 70s, if you are the NSA, and you have a giant database of that? Would that help you? Maybe. Or you just store the messages for a very long time, and as computing power increases, then you're able to crack them later. I feel like this problem is sort of showing its age, and the key size that is recommended continues to increase. What was considered a secure key size 10 years ago is no longer the case. But this is sort of just my total, you know, observer standpoint. I don't know what people who are closer to this problem, who are securing large systems, really feel about it.
I've heard that proposed too, as you know, computers get faster, the ability to brute force something becomes practical, or maybe in this day and age we call it affordable is the way to look at it, with commodity hardware available. There is a chance, yeah, let's just increase the key size. Instead of having 128-bit encryption, let's go to 256 or 512 or 1024. What are the advantages I get if I double my key size? Have I just made it twice as hard for an adversary?
Not necessarily. You might have made it a sort of like an... It's often in sort of the exponential. So for RSA, you know, it's an exponential as you go from 1024 to 2048 to 4096. It becomes exponentially harder each step up. Yeah, it's usually not, even if you're doubling the number of bits, you're not necessarily doubling the difficulty. You're usually creating an exponential around it.
Gotcha. All right. So that gives me some confidence that larger keys are a way to combat the speed of technology, at least in terms of brute force attacks. Taking everything into account, do you feel we should trust modern crypto? There's a lot of like asterisks next to these safety things, like, well, it's safe if this and if this and if we picked a good prime and all these sorts of things. The average person doesn't know too much about prime numbers and that sort of thing. Should the average person be trusting of modern crypto?
Yes, I think absolutely. It used to be that all cryptographic research was done in total secrecy at places like the NSA. And there was next to no information about cryptography, real cryptography, in the public domain. Of course, people knew about things like Caesar ciphers and their sort of mathematical curiosities, but nobody really knew how intelligence agencies were enciphering things. That is not the case today. There's a large academic community that's international that works on cryptographic problems. I believe that if there were true sort of fundamental issues with the math behind what we use for public cryptography and modern cryptography in general, that group of people would eventually discover it. Maybe they would discover it late, or maybe not. Maybe that group of people is actually larger than the group of people who are sort of working on the same problems in secret. I don't know, but that gives me confidence that it's no longer simply the domain of intelligence agencies. We really have a lot of smart people outside of those agencies who are publishing their work openly, who are finding solutions to the sort of these pressing cryptographic problems for us.
Yeah, absolutely. For me, it gives me a little bit extra confidence that the cryptographic problems are essentially based on problems that are otherwise still interesting in mathematics. So a researcher who cares not the least bit about cryptography, the fact that they fail to solve P versus NP and these sorts of things, gives us confidence that very smart people have looked at, can we break crypto? And to date, they've all failed to the best of our knowledge.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
We've kind of covered most of the basics of cryptography and the relationship with complexity theory. If you were a person wanting to go on into crypto, there's a lot of interesting direction it goes into quantum cryptography and man-in-the-middle attack, things we can discuss. There was one element along those lines I wanted to ask you to share that was a nice anecdote from your paper, and it's the situation of Ian and Mallory. I don't know if you recall it or if you could share that anecdote.
I was trying to sort of explain why you care about one-way functions, which are, like I said, the sort of the basis of modern cryptography. And so this is sort of my anecdote to explain them. Let's say Ian is an inventor and he's been working very hard on a new invention and he comes up with one. He decides his idea is so clever that he doesn't want to share it by patenting it. He doesn't believe that the patent system will be strong enough to protect it. But he's worried that if somebody steals it, he'll have no recourse. So what he does is he writes it down, and then he runs it through his one-way function. And he produces a sort of what he's calling a certificate of his invention. Looking at the certificate, you can't learn anything about the invention, or at least that's what Ian believes. And so he publishes it widely, sort of placing it in libraries all around the country or the world. And some years later, Mallory steals Ian's idea. Mallory thought, I'll be clever. I won't just use the idea, I'll patent it. And because Ian never told anybody about it, nobody will know that I didn't come up with it. So he patents it, and then he sues Ian for violating his patent. But because Ian had created this certificate and published it, he's able to prove that he had known about the idea long before Mallory had filed a patent, and that there was sort of what is called prior art. Hopefully the court would agree with Ian and sort of invalidate Mallory's patent. This explains why one-way functions are really useful, not just in cryptography, but any time where you want something sort of to produce that says, I knew about this, you can use one-way functions.
Very cool. So let me see if I follow everything completely. There's this legal concept of prior art. If, let's say, you patent something and then I'm able to prove I already knew that from a year ago, then either you can't patent it or maybe I'm, have some claim or something along those lines. It gives me a bit more legal power. Ian says, hey, I've put this random bit of characters in a bunch of libraries publicly several years ago. You all knew that was Ian's great idea, even though you didn't know how to read it. But now if I give you the key and show you how to decrypt it, you can see, aha, you did have the idea so long ago. Is that the basic concept?
Yeah, that's the basic concept.
How do we trust that Ian didn't just publish a string of gibberish and figure out the right key that would describe Mallory's brilliant invention?
Right. So, that's obviously what the court would be interested in knowing. It really comes down to the fact that you need to construct a function that would map the gibberish to a description of Ian's idea and still have it be a one-way function. perhaps what Ian should have done and maybe should do is publish the function he used as well as the key. That way you can't produce a function that does that mapping and looks like a one-way function. Mm-hmm. But that would be the only way, is if the function wasn't also sort of published, then maybe you could construct a function.
Ah, yeah, that's an interesting point. But yeah, if he published the function and the encrypted form, then short of reverse engineering a key, we know that that encrypted result came from his original design, I guess, yeah?
Yeah, exactly.
Very neat. Yeah, so there's that and many other interesting ways we could use one-way functions in addition to being able to securely purchase things over the internet. With that in mind, I feel like I have to ask, are there such things as one-way functions? Can we prove they exist?
Yes. So we hope at this point that one-way functions exist. If P equaled NP, then not only would, say, the traveling salesman problem or three satisfiability be easy to solve, but also the discrete log problem would be easy to solve, because since the discrete log problem is easier than the traveling salesman problem, you could solve it with your fast solution for the traveling salesman problem. So if NP equals P, everything is easy, and public key cryptography does not become possible. Let's say that it's not necessarily easy, but it's often easy. That we can use a lot of heuristics to mostly prove it. In this case, we can still do public key cryptography, but it becomes sort of very expensive. And then as sort of like the gap grows until we have sort of like a hard boundary between NP and P, we get to the point where we can definitely do cryptography, but maybe other things become less tractable than we want them to be. Because, of course, some of these problems, like the traveling salesman problem, we want to solve for other reasons than constructing cryptography, such as we're actually interested in, solving the problem itself. In fact, I would say that's like most of the time.
So what's the relationship between one-way functions and cryptography? How do we use them as the tool to build our crypto system?
One-way functions are not in themselves a cryptographic system. We need to construct one out of them. And it's actually interesting that, we talked a little bit about finding a one-way function as well, and I this kind of gets into it. And there are sort of different kinds of one-way functions. There's something that's called a strong one-way function, which means that it is going to be like really improbable that you can easily invert it. And these are probably sort of difficult to find. And so they came up with another version called a weak one-way function, which means that only on some sort of inputs is it difficult to invert. And they came up with a way to boost a weak one-way function into a strong one. But this kind of works, but it also leads us to a question, which is when you have a number and you run it through a one-way function, are all of the places in your original number difficult to construct from the outfit or difficult to invert? And it turns out that parts of those numbers are easy to find. And obviously, if we're constructing a cryptographic system, we want to make sure that all of our message is difficult to invert. So we actually have to take our one-way function, even a strong one-way function, and construct what's called a hardcore predicate from it, which is always difficult to invert. So once we've done this and we have our hardcore predicate, which is constructed from our one-way function, we can create a encryption scheme. The encryption scheme, what it's going to do is it's not going to be like perfectly secret, as we sort of talked about before. It's instead going to be really unlikely that an attacker is going to be able to learn anything. And we sort of express that unlikelihood in terms of a probability and say that if our attacker is capable of polynomial time computations, which means they can do normal computations that you and I can do, then they're very unlikely to be able to learn anything from the ciphertext, or it's going to take them a really long time. Once we have sort of our definitions and our one-way functions, what we can do is we can construct basically a random number generator that's secure from our one-way function. And we can use that random number generator, which is called a secure pseudo-random number generator, to create cryptographic schemes. the simplest of which is basically identical to the one-time pad scheme that we talked about at the beginning of the episode.
Well, Tim, well, in the time I've got you left, I know in the pre-show we were discussing how your work and your day job is really at the intersection of machine learning and software engineering. Those topics, machine learning in particular, are not anything that's going to be unusual to my listening audience. Can you tell me what you mean by that intersection?
Yeah, it's actually less of an unusual intersection than you might think. There's a whole lot of people in software engineering, which is really about creating tooling and concepts and theory to make software development better, that applies and invents machine learning techniques for software engineering. And I sort of work in a couple areas, and one of them is something called automated fault localization. And this, what you're trying to do is, let's say your program has a bug in it, and you want to know where the bug is, but you can't quite find it, so you want a hint. Automated fault localization is sort of like an automatic hint giver. It's going to use statistics or use text mining or use something else to sort of predict or give you a list of ideas for where to look for the bug. And I sort of work on a fancy version of that, which uses a data mining technique called frequent subgraph mining to sort of produce not just a little tiny location, but also some context around it.
Ah, very interesting. Maybe this is just in name alone, but I'm aware of frequent item set mining. How does that compare to frequent subgraph mining?
Right. So frequent item set mining is sort of the original pattern mining problem. It's what helps you fill your shopping cart at Amazon, for instance. You know, you've already got, you know, a CD and a movie, and so it suggests that maybe you also want a bag of popcorn or something like that. It basically looks at what people have frequently purchased together and is able to suggest a larger set based on previously purchased items. So frequent subgraph mining takes that problem of finding sets that occur together frequently in a database and looks for small graphs that occur frequently either in one giant graph or in a collection of tiny graphs. So it was originally developed for computer-aided drug design. Sort of the original study, what they did is they had a publicly available data set from the NIH of people who had AIDS. They had taken blood samples from them, and they had run them through sort of a molecular analysis to figure out what molecules were in their blood. What they did is they looked for frequently occurring subgroups of those molecules to try and identify drug targets.
So is the idea that amongst patients they would find these commonalities and that those were presumably indicators or part of the virus or something along those lines, and then they could target those specifically?
Yeah, exactly. So they were looking for something that was common among everybody, that wasn't something that like should be in the blood, and was potentially something that they could target, something to latch on to. That was sort of its first use case. Computer-aided drug design itself has sort of moved on from this problem because it doesn't model the complexity of molecules in enough detail, because there are, they're sort of like 3D shapes, and it's the graphs are 2D, so they have more complicated versions of it now.
Gotcha. And is this an unsupervised learning technique?
Yeah, so it's really a data mining technique, and it's unsupervised, and there's some like variations. So for instance, in the fault localization work, I do what's called discriminative subgraph mining, where I try and find these little shapes that distinguish one group of graphs from another group of graphs. So you can imagine that basically certain subgraphs or little shapes only occur on one side and not the other. So if you see that, you know that a new graph is probably going to fall on, say, the positive side or the negative side, which could be, you know, the side of your set that where the program is failing, or the side of your set where the program is not failing, or maybe the side of your set where the patient has a disease or falls into a particular group. For instance, in my work that is in bioinformatics, we use it for subtyping patients with cancer into different groups based on these little graphs, and those groups have different survivability curves.
Well, Tim, if listeners are interested in getting more into frequent subgraph mining and following your work on that topic, where's the best place for them to go?
Yeah, so if you're interested in learning more about frequent pattern mining and graph mining and some other variations, there's a great survey book, Frequent Pattern Mining, published by Springer in 2014, edited by Agarwal and Jiawei Han. It has really nice introductions to a number of the topics, and it's definitely the first place you should read if you just want to learn more about this really cool class of algorithms.
Very neat. I'll have a link to that book as well as your blog, hackthology.com, both in the show notes. Can I give a link to your Twitter as well, or do you want to announce the handle?
My Twitter handle is TIMTADH, which is my initials, and that is also my GitHub, where I have a whole bunch of software.
Sounds great. I look forward to going through that myself. Well, Tim, thanks again for coming on, taking the time to share your thoughts on this and the research paper you wrote up. I'm going to have a link to that and all the other things in the show notes.
Thank you so much, Kyle. I really enjoyed being on the program today.
Data Skeptic is a listener-supported program. To support the show, visit dataskeptic.com and click on the membership tab.